Well, okay. Of course, it is my pleasure to introduce Professor Maria Josefa Cánovas. I think it is the first time I introduce her. And what can I say? I met her several years ago, and from that moment, I decided to work every time with her. And I do appreciate very much her interest in going deeply the geometrical ideas of the problem, just to see what's happening. But I could say many things, but I'm not going to say anything more. So please, it is my pleasure to present her. Okay.
Good introduction. Well, in this talk, I'm going to present some results about the calmness property in linear optimization. It's the research of our group together with some collaborators. In fact, the talk is based on two papers plus one ongoing work. The first one by Jan Tute, Juan Parra, Javier Toledo, and myself. In it, we introduce a characterization for the calmness property of the ARCMIG mapping, the optimal set mapping. In the second one, together with Alex Kruger, Marco López, Juan Parra, Michel Terá, we provide different results about the calmness modulus, formula for the calmness modulus. And the last one, which is an ongoing work, deals with calmness for the feasible set mapping related to the constraint system in linear optimization. Well, this is the outline of the talk. First, we present the model in the introduction session, the model we are dealing with, and the calmness property. After some preliminary and key results, we present an overview on calmness for the feasible set mapping. After that, a characterization of the calmness for the optimal set mapping. And finally, section 5 gathers the result about the calmness modulus. Well, we consider a linear semi-infinite optimization problem given by finding the infimum of a linear objective function and subject to a set of linear constraints. Here, C and DATs, here in the constraint, are elements in Rn, in the n-dimensional Euclidean space. X represents the vector of decision variables, and for each t, bt in the right-hand side, which is in R, represents the right-hand side of the system. Our setting is the setting of a continuous problem in which T is assumed to be a compact Hausdorff space, and functions assigning to each T, the corresponding AT and BT, are continuous functions on T. In our framework, the pair C and V, V is the functions assigning to each T, the corresponding right-hand side, are the parameter. And the parameter space is endowed with the uniform convergence topology. Well, we consider three underlying mappings associated to our parametrized problem. The first one, capital F, is the feasible set mapping, depending on the right-hand side only. So it assigns to each B the set of solutions of the corresponding system. And capital S, the ARCMIG mapping, assigns to each pair CB the set of optimal solutions to the corresponding problem. And finally, we consider some kind of a partial solution mapping in the sense that here we fix C. And so it assigns to each V the set of solutions with always C fixed. Well, of course, when T is finite, our problem is nothing else but an ordinary linear programming problem. And when T is infinite, our problem is a linear semi-infinite optimization or programming problem. Well, now we introduce the calmness property. We say that a mapping between two metric spaces, y and x, is calm at the point of its graph, y bar, x bar, if there exists a neighborhood of the point, x bar, a neighborhood of y bar, and a non-negative constant, kappa, such that if we consider any other element y around y bar, and any image x around x bar in the corresponding neighborhood, then distance from x to the image, fixed image of y bar is bounded from above by kappa times distance between y and y bar. Well, some authors refer to this property as a upper Lipschitz property, in the sense that it avoids the mapping to increase at non-linear rate, at most at linear rate can increase. Other authors in the opposite side say that this is not at all a Lipschitz property, since here we have a fixed argument. Here the infimum of this constant kappa is called the calmness modulus. But calmness property plays a key role in mathematical programming, and in particular in optimality conditions, error bounds, stability of solutions, among others. And that's why in the last decade there is a growing interest in providing criteria for calmness. The property was introduced by Clark in 1976 in the context of functions and in relation to constraint qualification condition. And even for function, it's clear that calmness is weaker than Lipschitz property. Here, for instance, we have a simple example in which the function is calm at 0, 0, but it is not Lipschitz. And moreover, calmness is, let's say, an unstable property, in the sense that calmness at a point does not imply calmness around the point. Here we can show another example, even for functions. Here, for instance, we have calmness at 0, 0, but we have no calmness at this sequence converging to 0, since well, the red line represents the graph of this example. And here we have a sequence of points with an infinite slope. And so we have no calmness in this sequence. Well, Robinson in 1981 introduced a very close property called upper Lipschitz property. The difference is that the property introduced by Robinson was global, not local. The previous inequality in the paper of Robinson is required for the whole space. And finally, the current notion of calmness for multifunctions appeared in the book of Rockefeller and Wetz. And when confined to our linear optimization setting, we have that when t is finite, then both multifunctions F, recall the feasible set mapping, and S, capital S, the optimal set mapping, are calm. This is a consequence of a classical result of Robinson about calmness of polyhedral multifunction. And we can consider a stronger property for multifunctions, which is well known, the Lipschitz-like property, or also called Aubain property. The difference between this property and calmness is that here, look at this, here we had two free points around y bar. Recall that calmness, in calmness, here we have y bar instead of y prime. And it is a stronger property. Roughly speaking, we can say that this property, Aubain property, avoid the multifunction to increase at nonlinear rate, but also to decrease at nonlinear rate. And so, in these two points, the red one and the black one, we have no Aubain property. But in the Red Point, we had no calmness, since here multifunctions in relation to the nominal image increased at non-linear rate. But here, for instance, we have calmness. Well, through this concept of Aubain property, we have a clear sufficient condition for calmness when confined to our semi-infinite framework for the feasible set mapping. This, let's say, sufficient condition, this criteria, comes from the classical Robinson-Usescu theorem, which characterizes the calmness for a multifunction with a closed and convex graph in terms of this interiority condition. And for our feasible set mapping, this interiority condition is characterized through a Slater constraint qualification, that is, the existence of a strict solution of the system. So, in summary, this Slater constraint qualification constitutes a sufficient condition for calmness of this mapping. Well, in summary, we have, when t is finite, both multifunctions are calm at any point of the corresponding graphs. And under Slater constraint qualification, the feasible set mapping is calm at this point. Now we present two illustrations. In the first one, we have calmness clearly, since, have a look to the details. Here we consider as indexed the interval 0, 2 times pi, and for each index t, we represent here the corresponding AT in the left hand side. The blue line is the corresponding half line, and the solution for the corresponding inequality is the opposite half space. So when t runs over the interval, we have as feasible set this blue circle. And if we consider as nominal element here 1, always 1, the constant 1, then 0, 0 is an Slater point for the system. And so we have calmness for the feasible set mapping at any point, in particular at this point 1, 0. But if we consider this other system in which we have slightly modified its inequality, just multiplying by t, and consider as nominal element also t, here this system is equivalent to the previous one in the sense that it has the same feasible set. For each inequality, they are equivalence, but now calmness property fails at this point. We will see the details later, but now just observe that the ATs now are coming when these points approach the nominal element 1, 0, approach, then are smaller and smaller. We will come back to this detail. Of course, a Slater constraint qualification is not satisfied in this example, since when t is equal to 0, we have the trivial inequality. Now we present some preliminary and quick result. This is a very basic and well-known result. Calmness for a multifunction is equivalent to the metric subregularity of the inverse multifunction. This property, metric subregularity, was introduced by Joffe in 1979 and called regularity at a point. The final terminology was suggested by Donchev and Rockefeller in a paper of 2004. Now we come back to our framework of the feasible set mapping and the right-hand side perturbations. From now on, we denote by sigma of B the corresponding set of constraints, the constraint system. Here, the supremum function plays a key role. Consider the supremum function associated to B bar is fixed, and so the terminology S bar, corresponding to B bar, and observe that, on the one hand, the feasible set of B bar is just the sublevel set of the supremum function, the zero sublevel set, and recall, this is the right member in the metric subregularity property, and it is nothing else but the positive part of the supremum function. And so, a calmness property of metric subregularity of the inverse reads as the local error bound for this function S bar. So, in this way, we can apply the result which can be found in the literature about local error bound. Here we gather two of the characterization for local error bounds applied to this function S bar. Consider a point in the boundary of the feasible set. Of course, if the point is in the interior, the mapping is trivially calm, and so this is the non-trivial case. And here we have two characterizations. Both involve the subdifferential of the supremum function. This one, by Yasse and Korbelek, let's say, involves points outside the feasible set, while this other one, by Sen and Ng, which is called a strong basic constraint qualification, involves points in the feasible set, in the boundary of the feasible set. Let's read this condition. There exists a constant, a positive constant tau, and there exists a neighborhood of X bar such that this intersection of the ball, here we consider the closed unit ball, and the normal cone to the feasible set at this point is contained in this product, the segment 0 tau and the subdifferential of the supremum function for all points around X bar in the corresponding neighborhood and in the boundary of the feasible set. Now we are going to specify this condition, in particular the Sen and Ng condition, to our framework. And now we consider two underlying sets, since in fact our aim is to express the condition directly in terms of the coefficients of the system. And we consider the active cone, denoted by A, which is the cone generated by the ATs corresponding to active indices.
Convex cone.
And recall the active indices is formed by those indices for which the inequalities are satisfied as equalities. And C represents the convex hull of the same elements, the same ATs. We also will appeal to these two sets, well-known sets, which is the second moment cone, the convex cone generated by the ATBTs, and this other cone, the characteristic cone, which add to the previous one this half line. And in fact, in the way of specifying the condition of Sen and Ng, we will clarify in an easy way the role played by the Abadi constraint qualification. In fact, the problem of clarifying the role of this constraint qualification was motivated by this paper by Henrion and Autrata in 2005. Recall that Abadi constraint qualification is satisfied at the feasible point if the polar of the tangent cone to the feasible set at the point thus coincides with the closure of the active cone. In our framework, this polar of the tangent cone is nothing else but the normal cone, and it also coincides with the polar of the cone of feasible directions. In such a way, we can apply this result, which can be found in the book of Gobernan López, and to express the normal cone in terms of the characteristic cone. In fact, one can check easily that here we can replace K by N, by the second moment cone, and via an standard argument, we can prove that the Abadi constraint qualification may be expressed in this term. At this moment, just point out that the Abadi constraint qualification then is characterized through a condition which involve directly the coefficients, the ATVTs, and since con n is the convex cone generated by the ATVTs. It says that the intersection between the orthogonal of this element, x minus 1, and the closure of the second moment cone is the closure of the corresponding intersection. In fact, in order to characterize calmness, we not only need a body constraint qualification at the point, but also around the point. And we will also appeal, sorry, to this other condition, which is called uniform dual bandedness condition, which reads in the following way. There exists a constant, a positive constant tau, and a neighborhood of x bar, such that this intersection, the intersection between the ball, the closed ball, and the active cone, is contained in this product, the segment 0 tau, the interval 0 tau, times the convex hull of the ATs. And this is for all x around x bar in the corresponding neighborhood and in the boundary of the feasible set. Just observe that this convex hull is nothing else but the subdifferential of the supremum function for points, provided that x is in the boundary of the feasible set, and then in this case the supremum function is zero. So we can translate, let's say, the Sen and NG condition by these two ones. These two ones condition, when they hold together, we have a characterization of calmness property, the Abadi constraint qualification around x bar, and the uniform dual bandedness at this point. In fact, we can add a new characterization, which is, in fact, a linear semi-infinite version of a result of Klatte and Kummer in a paper of 2010. Just to say that here in this paper, the authors used calmness in relation to the convergence of certain algorithms. Now we illustrate this condition, and moreover, with one example, we show that these conditions are independent. In fact, we had examples showing that both implications are not held. Here we present just one, which is revisited, the first one example. And in this example, we have a Abadi constraint qualification around the point, but not a uniform dual bandedness. Observe that here, if we consider it was a 1-0 denominal element, we can consider a sequence of points, these red points, and in that point, in the boundary of the feasible set, the normal cone is just thus coincide, in fact, not with the closure, but even with the active cone. So we have a Abadi constraint qualification at all these points. This is just a graphical idea. And observe that the uniform dual bandedness condition does not hold, since here we have represented in the picture the red segment is the intersection between the ball and the active cone, and the black one, the black segment, represent for each point this set. It was the convex hull of the coefficient vectors. So if we compare the size of these two sets, it is not possible to include these sets in a uniform way into the other sets, and so the uniform dual bandedness condition does not hold in this case. Of course, we have no calmness. In the other example, in which calmness was satisfied, observe that both sets, this intersection between the ball and the active cone, and this other set are of the same size. In fact, they are equal in this example, and so we have calmness property. Well, from now on, we deal with the optimal set mapping, and for dealing with the optimal set mapping, we consider this feasible set mapping, which is the so-called level set mapping, which assigns to each pair alpha b the solution set of this system, which add to the original constraint system adds this level constraint, let's say, and we have this characterization for calmness of the optimal set mapping in terms of calmness of this multifunction, this level set multifunction, and it is also equivalent to calmness of the partial, let's say, optimal set mapping in which we fix C bar. Of course, after this characterization, a natural question arises, which is, does the calmness modulus of L provide the calmness modulus of S? Thus, they coincide? Do they coincide? The answer is negative. Here we can present a very simple example in R, in which if we consider as C bar 1 over 10 and B bar 0, then it is very easy to see that calmness modulus for the optimal set mapping is just 1. Roughly speaking, let's say calmness modulus for the optimal set mapping does not depend on the size of C, but it is not the case for mapping L. In this case, the size of C has some consequences on the calmness modulus. Here, for instance, if we add this level constraint and just perturb the right hand side by epsilon, then observe that the set of solutions enlarge in 10 epsilon, and so calmness modulus in this case is at least 10, so they do not coincide. So we have to consider a different strategy for tackling the problem of computing the calmness modulus of S. I will not enter in the detail, but just to show which are the necessary mapping, which are the mapping we have considered. We have considered a family of a subset of active indices formed by a subset of indices with less than or equal to n elements, and in such a way minus t is in the cone generated by these elements. Observe that this set is motivated by the Karas-Kontucker representation of a vector minus c, and the fact that the cardinal is less than or equal to n is due to Karas-Theodoric's theorem. Then we consider the following feasible set mappings. We add to the original constraint system this finite amount of constraint, which are the opposite to the corresponding one for indices in set D. This is, in fact, to force equality when we consider here B bar. And in such a way, when we consider the nominal element B bar, this set is nothing else but a subset of optimal solution with a fixed Karas-Kontucker representation, with a fixed D as a set of indices in Karas-Kontucker. Well, we represent by F sub D the associated supremum function, and just to say that in terms of these functions, and in fact in terms of these mappings, these feasible set mappings, we have in the case in which the optimal set reduces to only one point, when we have uniqueness and we have a Slater constraint qualification, then here we have a lower estimate for the calmness modulus of the optimal set mapping. And just observe that here this lim sub is in fact the calmness modulus of the previous multifunction. This multifunction associated to a fixed Karus-Kuntuker representation of optimal points. And when we consider t finite, then the same constant is in fact an upper estimate for the calmness modulus. So when we have both, when t is finite and we have uniqueness of optimal solutions, then we have the exact modulus through this formula. We go a bit deeply in this context in which t is finite and we have a uniqueness of optimal solutions, and in this case we present a new constant which is never bound, but which is, let's say, more operative in practice, an upper bound for calmness modulus. Here we consider matrices. This is the matrix formed by ATs in the rows, in this set of indices, and we consider this family of subset of active indices. Here the difference as before is that here we have exactly n indices, we have cardinal exactly n, we have the Karus-Kuntuker representation, and moreover the corresponding matrix formed by these ATs as rows is non-singular. By the way, this set is non-empty due to the uniqueness of optimal solutions. And if we take the maximum of the norms of the inverse of these matrices, we have in fact an upper estimate for the calmness modulus of the optimal set mapping. Just to observe that this maximum, this new constant, is in fact the Lipschitz modulus when the mapping is Lipschitz, it has the Owen property. Just to finish, a summary and a sketch of the results about the Lipschitz modulus. We have introduced two constants, C1 and C2, the first one, recall, involving this function f sub d associated to fixed Karus-Kuntuker representation of optimal solutions, and this other constant C2 in terms of norm of matrices. And when we have two conditions, the finiteness, that is when we are in ordinary linear programming, and the uniqueness, C1 provides the exact calmness modulus, and C2 an upper bound for this exact modulus. When we relax uniqueness, but still under t finite, then C1 provides an upper bound. And when we relax the finiteness of t, but still we have uniqueness, then C1 lower estimate for the calmness modulus. The general case still remains as an open problem. Well, and just finally, I present the references on the origin of calmness, on the origin of metric subregularity, the immediate antecedents, which have been referred in the talk. And finally, here I present some monographs which has been frequently used in our work. Thank you very much.
Is there any question? Remarks?
Something that we have already commented many times. Just, it seems very challenging just to apply all these very nice results to the case of standard linear programming, no? Because when you have to...
When you work with infinitely many inequalities, capital T is infinite, it's very difficult just to make some numerical implementation of these ideas. But in the finite case, yes. And so it's something that somebody, perhaps we or you, we have just to think about, just to exploit algorithmically, no, the idea of measuring the modulus of calmness or the modulus of Lipschitz, just in case in which capital T is finite, and so standard linear programming.
So if you presented an example.
Yes.
Example in which, depending on the formulation, you had calmness or not. So it may be the case that there is always a nice formulation for which you have calmness.
What we had seen in this example is that a small coefficient is bad for calmness. A small coefficient, because in this case we had no this uniform dual bandedness condition. So I don't know. Perhaps if we consider, we don't know exactly. If it's a good question to find.
Behind this example,
you lost closeness, because when multiplying by t, you get a 0, 0, which is nothing, and then you lost the closeness condition somehow, no?
The idea is always the same. Okay, if you have inequalities with the coefficients are small, just little changes provoke a drastic, dramatic changes in the feasible set and the stability, no? And so, to a certain extent, what is good is to have normalized coefficients. But this is not happens in reality. In reality, you have a real problem, you have some constraints, and the inaccuracies, the lack of precision is exactly in the coefficients in the problem. No, if you normalize and you make some preconditioning treatment, you are changing the real coefficients, and so you don't know the possible effect of small perturbations. But it's true. Even there is a more simple example. For any possible closed convex set, you have a Farkas-Minkowski representation. And so this enjoys all the all the possible good properties, but changing the representation.
Well, is there any other question? This is not my case. I will not ask any question. So this is the moment to close the seminar. To thank you for your participation and your attention until the end. And that's all. Thank you very much, and until next time.
Thank you. So.